So people just think treatment research is about finding a good method. It's actually got more value that can be used to test theories. And that's very important. The hardest part, I think, is finding the interesting research question to begin with. And it has to be of interest to you. I came up with mine. I must say I came up with it because I worked as a clinician for a number of years, and then it began with an observation that individuals who have language impairments in aphasia also always have restricted verbal short-term memory spans. That spurred my investigation of why are these two related? How are these two related? And at the time that I was doing this, there were two theories about how language and short-term memory were related. One was that words that we process are just processed and then sort of held in some separate verbal short-term memory store. So that's one approach. And then the other approach was that really retaining information for short periods of time happened at all levels of word processing. So you hold on to its meaning for a short time, it sounds, your brain has to hold on to these things while you're preparing to say a word or if you're repeating a word. And so that the verbal short-term memory was really intrinsic to word processing. So I was intrigued by this idea and said, I think that may be why they're both impaired in aphasia. So my theoretically oriented testing began with trying to find evidence for that. There were two sources of evidence for that I can talk about. One is developing associations between two cognitive abilities. So one ability is word processing. You need a good measurement of word processing, and another is a good measure of verbal short-term memory span. So over a number of years, I collected data from about 50 or 60 people with aphasia, and I collected it on measures of word processing, picture naming, and word recognition. So is this a word or not a word? And then each one also got measures of verbal span. And then what you do is you run regression analyses, correlating one measure with the other. And the goal is to find out if there's a severity continuum so that you want to find an association between a person's level of impairment of the word processing and how short their verbal short-term memory span is. So you would expect smaller spans with more severe impairments. So this is called a severity continuum. We did find that association. So that's one approach to finding that. And then the second approach is we happened to have the good fortune of evaluating an individual longitudinally, someone who we began to test him very early on after he had a stroke after surgery for an aneurysm, and we followed him for a year or two, and after about a year and a half, his word processing got better, and there's other elements that I'm not going to go into detail about that, but his pattern of error in repeating words changed for the better, and his span got bigger. So this is just an example of how there's another type of association. So as he gets better, both of these abilities get better in parallel. So, okay, that's fine. We have other studies that we did that showed associations between these two. But associations are not enough to establish a causal relationship, like that the verbal short-term memory is causing the word processing or vice versa. It just simply says they're associated. And that really was part of our theory, that the language problem is actually holding on to, maintaining the verbal representation so that the short-term memory is what's intrinsic to the word processing itself. So another approach to testing this and maybe establishing a more causal approach is to actually try to treat the disorder. So we had a third construct that we said caused both these impairments, and that was the ability to hold on to or retain the activation of the semantic and phonological representations of words. So we started to test that, you have to actually treat the problem. So you have to come up with, you have to find a way, if you say that that's the problem, you have to treat that problem, and then both should get better. Okay, just the way the young man's abilities got better as he recovered. So we hypothesized that that was the ability that was getting better. So that's where we're at right now. We have a couple of case studies where we've actually developed a treatment protocol to, we kind of turn the problem on its head. So if someone can't hold on to information for a very long time, that's what we're going to treat. We're going to ask them to process words, but with increased memory load. So it's a very simple means of increasing memory load. We ask them to hear a word and then wait 5 or 10 seconds and then repeat it. And they're very bad at that. Their performance goes down, but then with work training, they get better. And so you can begin to demonstrate a causal relationship if what you say is the problem and you're treating that directly and the symptoms get better, then you can have better grounds for saying one causes the other. One more thing I wanted to say just about methodology. So you can do this in a whole treatment study, but it's probably better first to do what we call a facilitation study, which is a short term. So you want to test your method first, which is also what we're doing now to make sure that, so in a very one session treatment protocol, you see if there's an immediate effect, even if it doesn't last for very long. So that to me is a very good way, at least in my area of study with the adult aphasia patients, people, to connect theory with the treatment. And in the middle of that is your evidence that you've established. So in general, I feel that our field does call for evidence-based practice, which is very good, but I'm also very much an advocate of having a theoretical base for that, and as the field is, but I think it could be emphasized a little more.